For this episode of That Sewing Blab, we interview David Page Coffin. He was the editor of Threads magazine, is an author of three fabulous books, and much more. I hope you enjoy the interview. Without further ado, the fabulous David Page Coffin on That Sewing Blab. And you were talking about how you started sewing, and it came from like a need, but a want for nicer clothing, like dress shirts.
Well, it was more, I'd say, a question of wanting to have some control over my persona in an environment where I felt like I was totally a fish out of water. After college, I was an art major, hippie, working in an insurance company. And so I thought, well, at least I should be able to wear clothes that I'm more interested in and not just the default, whatever I can afford. And as I was saying before, from a very early age, I was interested in clothing for its own sake, and also for the sake of the idea that some activities require different kinds of clothes, which I ran into when I went to an English school in the elementary school in England. And they had uniforms for all sorts of different activities. So that really struck me. I thought, wow, this is better than back home in the States where they would just wear the same old junk, whatever is going on any old time. And I'd always appreciated colors and fabric patterns, and had been struck in high school by how much more interesting the fabrics that women's clothing came in. Anyway, so here I am in my early 20s, working in an office and wanting to have access to some more personal choices in terms of clothing that weren't entirely based on what I could afford, which wasn't much. So when a friend of mine came to a meeting we had wearing a coat that I thought was interesting, and he said he'd made it himself, this was really literally the first time it ever occurred to me that maybe it would be interesting to make your own clothes. Part of that may have been that it wasn't until I was out of art school that I had more confidence in myself in this, in terms of being a maker of things. I'd always like to have control of choices, but to have the craft skills, I thought, I'm sure I could do that without having any real idea what that meant, but I just had the confidence. And so putting those two things together, I was excited, and I went and bought a sewing machine and started going to the library and looking at books about sewing and just kind of getting involved. Turned out it was not anywhere near as easy as I'd anticipated, but and it wasn't for another 10 or 12 years that I really had a sense that I had figured out how to do the first project which I had set for myself, which was, well, I'll make some shirts. That surely is not difficult. And I would only need one pattern. So, because all the shirts I have basically look the same except for the fabric and a few details. So that's how I started.
Sorry about interrupting there. How did the first shirt end up looking, like, in your mind's eye?
Well, I made it for my wife, and it was certainly wearable, but it was a shock to me to see the difference between what the Vogue pattern, it was a Ralph Lauren designer pattern for a sort of a Western-like shirt for women. And I was very conscious of what high quality shirts were like from a construction standpoint. I mean, I wasn't thinking about them so much from as construction details as simply interesting details, things that in my mind as sort of a connoisseur of a buyer were hallmarks of a high quality shirt. And none of these were explained in the Vogue pattern directions. I mean, I didn't learn at all from them how to do the things that I thought were just a given for a high quality shirt. It was a bit of a shock. So the shirt came out okay. I mean, it was wearable, even though it was a beginning project. It was clear to me that I had no idea how to actually make a shirt like one of the ones that I would have wanted. And the Grail quest that set me on was what took all the time, 10 years. It wasn't for a couple of years later when I was able to buy a Bernina to replace my Kenmore that I found that it came with a roll and hem foot or roll and fell foot, something like that. And it was, my God, that's how you make these tiny little flat felt seams that were on all my expensive shirts, most of which came from thrift shops, because that was the most reasonable way to get a hold of an expensive shirt in my situation.
How did you get from, beginnings, making shirts, going to the library, learning all this stuff, to being an editor at Threads?
Well, so as I said, 10 years later, I was still at this weird project of figuring out how to make a shirt for myself. And I must say, it was a mystery to me while I was doing it, why I was bothering, but there was no mystery about my willingness to keep doing it. I was really kind of driven by it and I enjoyed the project, even though I had a day job I hated and a first priority hobby, which was my career wish to be an artist. So I was spending most of my time when I wasn't at work doing painting evenings and weekends, but somehow in there, I also fit in this weird hobby of, well, I'm still trying to figure out how to make a shirt. So after 10 years or so of doing that, I got pretty good at it. And somewhere along the line, I got the equally surprising idea, surprising compared to the idea that I would sew something. And that was, well, maybe I'll write a book. And it was, I was really looking for, a self-employment opportunity that would be different from just showing up at work and working for an hourly wage doing something. I thought I need make some money while I was sleeping, to have something that would just sell without me having to redo it every time. So I thought to myself, I didn't mean a novel, I meant a how-to book. Because most of my life in libraries and so forth was devoted to how-to stuff. I had hundreds of watercolor books and lots of sewing books. And the two things that I figured I could write about were watercolor and shirt making. And it was pretty clear that there were plenty of watercolor books already. And there weren't any shirt making books. I'd been looking for them for 10 years there was nothing there. So I got that idea. And so the very first thing I did was flip to the back of Sew News, which was the magazine in those days. This was in the early 80s, I guess, to see what it would be like to get an ad, to take an ad out for a book. And I learned, this was January, that I had to place the order now and the ad would appear in March. And I thought, well, okay, I'm sure I could write a book in 3 months. How big should it be? How much should I charge for it? I need to get this ad out. So I put together a little ad and sent it in and then started writing. I pretty much made my deadline. It was a couple of weeks off. But the two things that were most interesting about that experience were that as I sat down to write it, I realized that this was probably the best answer I was ever going to get as to why I'd been so interested in shirt making, because it really wasn't about wanting to make an endless number of shirts or to make shirts for other people or anything like that. It was that Grail quest, to gather up all the info to do it the way I wanted to, that had been so interesting. And the impulse that went right along with that was, well, once I figured it out, let's share it with people. So writing the book was the sharing process, and it was a 3-month revelation. It was kind of a, my God, this is really what not only why I've been interested in clothes and shirts all this time, but this is what I should be doing. I love doing this. It's totally fascinating. And, you know, this was totally pre-computer, certainly pre-internet, of course. So I didn't know how to type. So I wrote it out in pencil, and I did all the drawings with a little rapidograph pen. And I was working by that time as a delivery person for a legal firm. And I had a friend there who was a legal secretary. So I would read my text into a cassette player and give her the cassettes, and she would transcribe them. And my theory for the illustrations was, well, as long as I put all the illustrations on a single page, I won't have to do any cutting and pasting of her typed pages. So that was the simple production logic that I was using. And basically, I took her typed pages and my pen and ink drawings and collated them together and took them down to the Xerox shop to have the book made. And, you know, it was comb bound and so forth. So that's how that all went together. And as I said, it was a total thrill and a revelation. And the other important thing was that within a week of my getting my first copy back from the comb binder and having all those orders to fill, because I got orders right away from when the ad finally appeared in March in So News, I also got a flyer in the mail from the Taunton Press saying they were starting a new magazine called Threads about fiber arts, including sewing and knitting and quilt making and weaving. Those are all things my wife was involved in and I'd been helping her with. So my first reaction instantly was, these people need me.
Yeah.
Because I discovered I want to be a sewing writer. It wasn't that I want to be a sewer or that I wanted to be a clothing manufacturer or just to keep my shirt making as a hobby, because I had an endless need for shirts. I didn't really have an endless need for shirts. So anyway, I sent them a copy of the book, and within a week, they called me up. They thought my book was really cool. They were going to send it over to the publishing end. And would I be interested in doing an article for Threads? Well, of course, obviously, I'd be interested. So they adapted the collar making section. It appeared in issue 4, Threads. In issue 5, they ran an ad saying they were looking for an editor. I was on the phone the minute I got it, and I was working there by issue 7. So they yanked me out of San Diego and yanked us back to Connecticut, and we were there for 18 years. And it was absolutely a dream job. Not just a fantastic job in itself, but a fantastic vindication of this idea that I heard later, which was, do what you love and the money will come. You know, I mean, I was nearly 40 years old by the time this happened, certainly in my late 30s. And I had basically loathed every single job I had to do up to that moment. And here was the first time ever that I was finding it more interesting what I was doing at work than what I wanted to do with my free time. Because it was the same thing. Plus, they were giving me a bunch of money and tools and freedom to just pursue my own interests, because my interests matched theirs. That was the real revelation. And every other job, it was clear I was just doing somebody else's chore, and I didn't care about their chore. I was only doing it because they were paying me to do it. And they were only paying me to do it because it was horrible to do and they didn't want it to. So that's how I got into it.
Oh, well, they were lucky to have you. I love how you thought, like, as soon as you saw the job, they need me.
Yeah, well, I was surprised. I've never thought that before.
Okay.
In every other case, it was, oh, gosh, what do I need to do to be the person that could get to do that? You know, and this was the one and only time where I thought, I'm already doing that. That's what they need. They need me. And it wasn't just because I wanted to do it. It was also because in the process of writing that book, the main thing that was really interesting about it was that I was discovering that my Grail quest had not only taught me about sewing, but it had given me a lot of opinions about the kind of book that I wished I had had, the kind of book I would want to have to teach me anything I wanted to know about sewing. I was really shocked by that first Vogue pattern. You know, it was supposedly to show me how to make a shirt, No, not from my point of view. That wasn't a shirt. That was just a garment that was hacked together that kind of looked like a shirt. And in terms of anything else I wanted to do about shirtmaking, there was no book out there on it. And all the patterns and books were all relentlessly aimed at a female audience that was making dresses for themselves and clothes for their family, probably their children. So I just had this idea, well, you know, what about me? I'd like a book that was aimed at me, someone like me, a serious adult kind of gourmet sewer. Somebody wanted to do it, really do it up in the right way with good stuff and good information. And the other fascinating thing, I guess, that I should mention was that when I first went to the library in my early days, 10 years earlier, when I first got the idea to start sewing, you know, I went to the library. That's where all my watercolor info came from. So I figured that's where all the sewing info would come from. And they had a great section, and I hauled all those books back to my house over the course of many months and flipped through many of them and read many of them. But tucked in there in the midst of the Vogue sewing book and the Simplicity book of sewing shortcuts and all that kind of stuff, were four self-published tailoring manuals. I don't know how they got there. This was Elmhurst, Illinois, and the guy who wrote the books was in Seattle. Someone had bought them, and they were the class notes from a first class men's tailor who had been teaching in the Seattle college system, teaching tailors for years, for decades, and had been convinced to take his class notes and bind them up and self-publish them. So here were four books that completely vindicated my reaction to the Vogue stuff and the Simplicity stuff, which was, this can't be the whole story. This is a packaged version of some thing that humans have been doing for centuries at all sorts of different levels. And they're just giving me a tiny little window on it. You know, and the idea is, well, all you have to do is buy this pattern here, you know, flip to the catalog and pick your garment and then go to the store and they'll have all the fabrics you need and everything will be there. Well, in this series of self-published tailors class notes, the most immediate way of showing the difference was that in the Vogue sewing book, there was maybe two pages on hand stitches. Well, one of these four volumes was entirely devoted to hand stitches, or like 70 pages on the hand stitches you needed to know how to do to be a tailor. The book on making a sport coat was 300 pages long, not just six pages of folk instructions, or even eight pages. So, and the things that he was talking about and the ways he was doing everything were just completely different, different universe. So not only did I get the idea that, yeah, there is more to this than you can learn from just buying the Vogue sewing book, or if you even bother to go that hard, high and heavy, but you could self-publish a really interesting and informative document about how to do this stuff. It didn't have to be any more complicated than these books that he did, which were, they were just typewritten sheets with nice hand-drawn black and white line drawings, and the information was all there. So that was, you know, one of those seeds being planted right at the beginning. And when I got to threads, this is the best part, is I corresponded. I bought my own copy of these books, and I corresponded with the author. He sold materials and fabric to go along with his instructions. And I had some letter exchanges with him. When I got to threads, the first thing I said at my first staff meeting, when we were talking about, well, what are we going to do? What are next topics? I said, well, there's this great guy in Seattle who wrote these wonderful books. Let's do some articles with him. And so, you know, within a couple of months, they sent me on an airplane to Seattle to spend a week in Stanley Hostek. He was the author's basement with a video camera. Documenting it all, and they gave me the video camera and taught me how to use it. So, I mean, this is why it was the perfect job. I never actually used a video because obviously I was really not a videographer at that point. But we did developed several articles, and I visited Stanley at least a half a dozen times over the remaining years. We did other articles. And every time I came to Seattle, I always stopped in to see him. And that was what made it such a beautiful job, that I was immediately able to spend my days thinking about what would make a good article or a good topic for someone like me, because I was a perfect example of the Threads readership that they wanted. And it was my job to get on the phone with anybody who I thought would make a good author. And when they heard that I was calling from Threads magazine, they pretty much invariably said, oh, stop everything. Sure. What do you want? You know, how can I help? And so my next thing would be, well, how about if I come visit you? Sure. When are you coming? You know, and Threads would give me the plane ticket and the expense account and the rent a car and then take them out to dinner and a fantastic camera kit that I brought with me so I can document what we're talking about. Those were the good old days. Unfortunately, I had no idea they don't do it that way at Threads anymore. The people that I still know there told me years ago that they just don't travel anymore. They don't hardly even go to trade shows. I don't know how they do it, but I was there during the golden age, and it was really marvelous. So when they got back to you, I became a sewing authority. When I'm really just somebody who's likes to meet other sewing authorities and help them prepare articles. So.
Oh, I think part of it too is your personality. Like, you do really like the details of things and you love learning. So it seems like literally, if they were to say, what's a good job for David and build it from the ground up, like backwards, that way, reverse engineer it, it would have been that job.
Precisely.
Sounds like it was very exciting. What was it like when you first heard back about your first book being published, not self-published, but published by, you said, Taunton Press?
Well, it was, that was a kind of an odd story. It took years for that book to finally come out. And, ultimately it was thrilling. It was great. And we even made a video there. The reason it took so long to come out was that the owner there had a policy that they didn't do royalty products with any employees. In other words, if you worked there, you could sell a book idea to them, but it would be a Taunton Press book and you would just get paid your salary for doing it. But they saw my book before I worked there, and that little thing made a big difference. And so the books department wanted to do the book before I even was hired. The fact that I was hired before they did it meant that we had to spend at least 4 years, I think, maybe it was even more, dealing with the owner's resistance to, oh, wait a minute, I just don't like the idea of getting into a royalty arrangement with somebody who's also my employee. But he finally knuckled, and we did the book that way, and I'm still getting royalties from it.
And that's the first book, the Shirtmaking book? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes.
And there's also a video that came along that we did later based on that book.
Yeah, I think I saw it on Amazon.
Yeah, they're both still out there. Still.
And all the books, too.
Still doing well.
Yes. So you made the first book. I'm trying to understand kind of the pathway. And you're working at Threads, living it up, traveling around the country.
The world. They sent me to Europe several times.
Is it really the ideal job? Yes. How did you end up making this? Did you just see another niche?
Well, like another thing that I decided that I'd been doing on my own, making pants and kind of solving those questions. One of the great things also about the Threads job was that we had an obligation to author a couple of articles every year. I'd been making pants and never actually done a Threads pants article, but I had enough information so that I was giving workshops on pant making. So when I finally left Threads, after 18 years or so, it was mostly because even that wonderful job was kind of getting boring. I was spinning my wheels and not doing much of interest. So when I left and we moved out here to Oregon, one of the thoughts that I had about, well, what will I do when I leave was, well, I'm going to self-publish another book. and it'll be on trousers. I'd done the research over the time. I had a bunch of info. Of course, one of the great things about writing a book is that it requires you to fill in all the gaps of what you haven't already, questions you haven't already answered for yourself. So it's a research project as well as a record of research you've already done. And by this time I was, you know, I had a computer and the internet, and I had Adobe Illustrator and Photoshop, and I had, knew how to take photos, and it was pretty clear that it was clear to me that I could, if I'd wanted to, I could have gone to the woods in Oregon and created another Threads magazine. I had all the tools right there in my little sewing room. All I needed was a computer and a camera.
Yep.
Because the Threads was put together in Adobe Illustrator, Photoshop, and InDesign. Why couldn't I do it? So yeah. I thought, well, I'll put together a PDF version of my next book. It won't be print. It won't have any of the restrictions of having to buy paper, and stockpile, have an inventory. It'll just be a download. But not only will it be a download of book pages in a PDF, I'll be able to put multimedia in there. Because that was also one of my first thoughts at Threads, which nobody ever picked up on. And that was, well, if we're doing a knitting article or a knitting book, say, the best way to show somebody a knitting stitch would be a little video clip, you know, instead of a series of diagrams. Why don't we just do little video clips? And how would we do it? You know, back in those days, it would be, well, you'd bind in a disc with a book. Yeah. Maybe someone's doing that now. I never saw anything like that since. That was right away, you know, let's use multimedia the way that to me made the most sense, which was, why do you need multimedia? Well, there's some things that are better told with sound or picture or moving pictures. If you're going to give someone a bibliography, you don't want to see a video of someone reading it. You want the text. But if you're going to have the text, let's have it online so you can click on all the titles and go right to Amazon. So digital is better in that way. But if you're going to show someone how to do something, let's switch over to a video when we're doing that, or maybe an animated diagram or something like that. So that was the impulse behind Pants book. But it started as a self-publishing project, and it was only after that was out. It's got all the online content. So I self-published it again, and same problem with self-publishing. You know, you can do just exactly what you want, but then you have to sell it. And how do you sell it? So it wasn't long before I connected with a friend I'd met at Threads, who was now an acquisitions editor at another company. And I sold her the idea of, well, let's turn this PDF thing that I made into a real book, a publisher's book, but put all the multimedia on a disc that goes into the book. Now it's been moved over to just download stuff online. And so that was also the idea behind the book that you said you bought first, which is the Shirtmaking Workbook.
I think, like, you really can't, I don't know how to get across to anyone who hasn't read your books before. Like, it's not just like the odd picture here and there. You know, sometimes like it'll have multimedia included and there's like two pictures or one pattern. I mean, when you do things multimedia, when you have other online content, there's a lot there. And it's very good, very easy to read, very clear, very interesting. And like patterns, like I think there's over 100 in this book.
I never even eventually counted them, but there's definitely 100. Probably many more. But the most interesting thing to me is the great thing about multimedia as a creator, particularly one who's worked in the paper publishing world, where everything is limitations. The idea that for every article I did at Threads, I always wanted more pages than would be assigned. If I got a 6-page article, that was as far as I could go. I think I once in my 18 years there, I managed to get an 8-page article. But with digital content, there's no paper. So an extra page or an extra 100 pages doesn't cost anything except the time to put it together. So for in the pants book, I had a great opportunity while I was making that to visit Claire Schaefer at her house and spend some time there while I was working on another multimedia project with her. And I said before I left, I told her about my project, and I knew she had a lot of great clothes, and her husband did too. He's a surgeon, and they spent a lot of time traveling the world and buying fancy clothes for their various collections. So I spent an afternoon in their closets just photographing all the custom-made and high-end designer trousers that they had inside and out. So I had I put together over 170 pages of PDF of full-page photos of Yves Saint Laurent and Huntsman, Savile Row, custom-made stuff, because I could. And it only took me an afternoon of photos, a couple of days of editing and then putting it into the PDF. Just didn't take that long. But where else are you going to get 170 pages to show inside photos of fancy trousers? No publisher would ever agree to print that on paper.
Yeah.
So exactly that same idea is in the Shirtmaking Workbook. It was originally conceived as a pattern collection for details of shirt making. And I thought, well, the book part will just be the catalog. You know, you'll flip through it to see what the patterns are. And by the time it was finished, it still is that. But in terms of the how-to content, there was just too much of it. And so I'll just put that online. That'll be in a PDF. So there's 40 pages on how to sew various sleeve plackets, but they're not just pages. They're two-page spreads that will fill, the entire IMAX screen that I've got here, because they don't have to be printed. They take the shape and form of a computer screen. So there's hundreds of pages in there of how-to info, as well as hundreds of printable pages of pattern details. And that, as far as I'm concerned, is the real meat of that book. The paper part is just kind of, as I said, it's the catalog. It's the, start here.
Yep. I'm just trying to see if I can load up a couple of the pictures that she sent me. The computer's being a little fiddly.
I noticed someone has asked, is there any chance to get copies of those four books, referring to the Stanley Hostek stuff? As far as I know, they're still in print. He's no longer alive, but he's got some people in Seattle that are still selling his books, and I'll definitely track it down and make sure that Dawn gets a link to post to where you can get them. Michael has given us a link.
Yes, that was very lovely of him. Thank you very much, Michael, for that. And yes, here's one of the pages of extras that you were discussing.
Right.
And like, there really is, it's beautifully done, like how you have photos as well as drawings. And did you do all the drawings as well on here?
Yeah, that's just me and Illustrator.
You were saying that you actually even do that for other people as well. You have in the past?
Well, one of the freelance jobs that I've had since I left Threads, I actually started doing it while I was at Threads, is doing the how-to sheets, the pattern directions for some independent pattern company owners. They come out with a new pattern and they send a sample to me, and I do the directions, and sometimes the layout for the pattern envelope, that kind of thing. I don't do any, they get the grading done for the pattern itself. I do it themselves, or they get some pattern making person to do that. But in terms of the how to make this pattern directions, I've been making those for the past 15 years or so. all in Illustrator, same thing. And it's exactly what I was doing at Threads, basically figuring out what the steps are, writing the directions, and in this case, illustrating them, which I didn't have to do at Threads.
Oh, okay. This is another one of the pages from some of the online content. And yeah, it's very clear, very easy to read. Lots and lots of fabulous examples too. Like just for inspiration, you could pick these up and yeah. So stop sharing.
Yeah, it's pretty clear from some of the Amazon reviews that I've read that, that not everybody gets this right away, that the meat is in the, it's not in the book, it's in the online content. And there've been some definite snafus about making it easy to access them. Right now, the link that's in the book is not going directly to the actual place where they're located. So I've been posting the real URL and helping people who send me emails, but it's still there. The book's still out. It's not a problem. And if anybody does have a problem, by all means, just get in touch with me. I'm easy to reach. I'm sure you can give them my email somewhere, some link later.
Okay.
And I'm on Facebook with under my own name and under Shirtmaking with DPC and Making Trousers and all that kind of thing. So it's easy to find me, and I make it easy to get a hold of all this stuff if you're having any trouble from the books. That, of course, the other downside of not being self-published, that you turn over all that, the responsibility for that to a publisher. And they lose interest a lot sooner than you do.
Okay. And yes, and I have another one here. This is some of the patterns that you can see from your online content. Sorry, it's taken me a little while.
Yeah, and this was where I started with the idea. And it was basically, these are full-size printable patterns tiled onto regular, you know, letter size paper.
Yep.
A lot of them are for small details that don't require multiple pages, but many of them do. So that you're seeing there is a cowboy shirt, placket, cuff. The other ones above it are standard dress shirt plackets. There's dozens of different placket designs in there.
Oh, I couldn't get over the amount of content. Like, it's almost like you should put the book in a gigantic box, you know, right, so people get an idea that, oh,
that would be nice.
Here. But I guess that doesn't, you know, ship well. But I stumbled upon it. I don't know what rock I was living under. And then I just thought, yeah, if you want to make a shirt anytime, and you need these books, like I just think they're fantastic. That's why I was so excited about asking you to come on the show. I didn't know that you had such an interesting life as well with Threads. And when you were talking about your watercolors earlier,
I didn't do those the drawings in the pants making book. I mean, I
you
did
didn't
the
do
technical
those
drawings. I didn't do the fashion drawings.
Oh, okay. I thought you did those as well in there.
No, that's one of those publisher ideas that they thought, well, this is too dry. It's just sewing diagrams and construction photos. And so we need some fashion in there. And so I don't mind them in there, but they're just like, while you're reading the book, you're at a bus station and there's a bunch of people walking around you and they somehow popped onto the pages. What are they doing there? They're not showing you anything, but,
just glam it up. It's the lipstick.
Right.
So you've written these books. What are your plans for the future?
Well, I'm right in the middle of yet another book. Presumably the thing that will wrap up my shirt making description, my life's work on covering the shirt. I'm sure there'll always be something else to say about it, but The thing that I've never really devoted any attention to in any of my books is fitting. The very first shirt book that I started with at Taunton Press, one that you eventually bought, does have some fitting info in it. I mean, I figured it, I had to discuss it, and I did have some solutions, but I've always avoided fitting since then. But I finally decided, well, that's really the next topic. And one of the reasons I avoided it was that I was meeting so frequently expert sewers who were fitting experts. And the reason they were fitting experts was because they had actually challenged themselves to solve the fitting problems of lots of different other people, either because they were dressmakers or tailors, or they just made it their thing that they were interested in, and they'd written books on it, and they were selling their services as fitting experts. And I used some of them, but I certainly did articles with many of them. And I could see, well, that's not me. I haven't made clothes for lots of different people. I haven't struggled to fit lots of different people. So I'll just leave that out of my books. And in fact, I'll advise people in the books to, if they want to solve their fitting problems without becoming a fitting expert, that they should go hire a fitting expert to make themselves a good shirt pattern or a good pants pattern. Well, eventually I began to realize that as I would give classes, et cetera, and even online, the main thing people would always want to know is, well, how do I, before I make this shirt or this pair of pants, how do I make sure it fits? And I discovered that I actually had a lot of strong opinions and helpful ideas, and also a sense of what to say when people would say, well, does this fit and how do I fix it? So that's what the next book is about. How to fit a shirt in various different ways. And also there will be patterns for shirt bodies as opposed to shirt details.
So if I scroll down below, we have a couple of questions.
Sure.
Samina from
Sewing. The barking puppy is mine.
Okay. Samina from Sew Everything says, what was it like to do crafty classes? Are they more royalty friendly?
Well, I would say that first of all, Craftsy is a young, hip company that's very fast moving, and they're constantly changing things from year to year, not just staff, but the way they do things. And so it's been a couple of years since I did my last Craftsy class, and I'm not exactly sure that they're doing everything exactly the same way they did when they did it for me, or with me. But I would put it squarely in between the process of doing an article and doing a book, both in terms of the amount of time you put into it and the what you get back in terms of money. It's not exactly right there in the middle, but it's a lot more work than doing an article. But that again depends on the article. Some people I did articles with, the only reason they could do an article was because they spent a lifetime learning how to do what they did. Nowhere near as big a project as doing a book, but you do have a lot of preparation, 2 or 3 months of working with your Craftsy editor. And then they fly you to Denver, and you've got a 2-day shoot. So that goes pretty quickly, assuming that your preparation was done well. And then you get a lot more from doing that than you would from a typical sewing article, or even a non-typical one like Threads, where they pay a lot more than pretty much any other sewing magazine I know of. But of course, your class has to sell. I know some people there who've done classes, and they've been very disappointed in how many people have taken the class. And then there are other people who, they've sold 20,000 people have taken their class. And you pretty much get a couple of dollars every time a class is sold. So you can work it out from there. Both of my classes have sold nearly 4,000 viewers. So over the years that I've been at Craftsy, the royalties have rolled in to total about a dollar or two per person taking the class. And, you know, pretty much every class is sold during a sale. So it's a $20 class, but it doesn't make, as Craftsy producers, we love the sales because that's when the sale, the class membership numbers really shoot up. So I definitely enjoyed working with Craftsy, and it's a great deal if you can get in there and you've got a class that people want to see. And of course, that's their main goal too. They don't want to produce classes that no one wants to see. From a maker of information point of view, the thing that I loved about Threads was that we were not driven by advertising or by some suit from marketing who would tell us what topics we should work on. They figured that we knew that, and that they also figured that the reason the people who loved Threads loved it was because they were just like us editors. They weren't like the bean counters who would do a survey to see what was the most popular topic and then do an article on that. They figured we knew what was interesting to people and we should just, you know, be let loose to do it. Craftsy is my first impression when I was there was, wow, this is just another sort of Taunton Press. It's very similar. A lot of the same sorts of people, but they're the production people, not the managers. You back?
Yeah, sorry about that. I had double David in my ear for no reason whatsoever.
Right.
And it was fine. It's just that sometimes I couldn't tell what you were saying now.
Sure. Do I have to start over, repeat anything?
No, you sound fabulous. For some reason, great. I swear tonight this show is possessed. You are being so understanding, David, and people watching. Wow. Thank you. For some reason, it started playing the sound of the beginning of the show.
Right.
While we were doing the show. So
I hope you can edit it into something that looks better on YouTube when you get around to that.
Oh, yes. It's
for your
fabulous.
Sake. It's been fine for me. Anyway, the point I'm making is, as an existing author there, I still feel like, well, the issue is with Craftsy is much more, well, how well did your class sell? Whereas with Threads, it was always, well, what do we think the sewing world would really need in terms of information that they don't have? So we were able to have a very editorial perspective, in other words, a pedagogical one. We weren't thinking what's going to sell best. We were thinking, what information do they need? Whereas Craftsy is, of course, driven by marketing. It reminds me of my one experience as a marketer. I worked briefly managing a little greeting card company, my wife and I, partly because we just knew somebody who needed help. But the other side was that we were both painters and interested in illustration and the kind of art that goes on greeting cards. So we thought, well, you know, maybe we'll make our own greeting cards too. The reason I bring it up is because there were one or two of the few cards we sold that had images of cats on them, and they just towered above all the others in terms of sales. You know, you could say 2, 3, 4, 5, 50 if there's a cat on it, 50 orders. So any idiot who was running that company would have to conclude, well, if we're going to make another card, it was put a cat on it, right? So obviously when Craftsy looks at a bunch of classes they've made and they're rolling along with a bunch of classes that are doing this well, and then someone comes along completely out of the blue and does a bra making class and it sells 30,000 viewers. Well, wow, let's do more of those. it's perfectly understandable. It's not like a conspiracy or anything. It's just based on, well, if we're going to put all this effort, let's make sure we put it in into something that's going to pay back well. So that's more the way you have to sell a story to Craftsy, as opposed to, say, selling an article to Threads. Threads will want it because of its content, because they haven't done it and they think it's of interest. Craftsy will do it, maybe a little bit of that, but mostly because they need to be convinced that anyone would buy it. You know, Threads, you're already subscribing, presumably. Are you going to buy it anyway? Let's just make sure that it's always as good as it has been. But for Craftsy, it's individual items. And also, it's with Craftsy, there's a heavy emphasis on how many classes did the author themselves sell. You know, and again, very typical. When I was doing self-published books, with my, I did that pants book, as I described, but I also did self-publishing projects with other authors where I did all the production. Basically, they gave me a workshop and I videoed it and photographed it and I put it into a disc and we sold them. This was after I left Threads and it was very interesting. But the single most interesting part was it didn't matter what the content was. What mattered was whether the author I was working with already had an audience and a built-in way of reaching that audience. So of all the people I worked with, one of them was Marcy Tilton. And she's got a great website, and she's got a big mailing list. Lots of people just want to know whatever she's thinking and whatever she's doing. And so when we did projects together, and she would throw up the idea that, well, I've just done a new a CD-ROM class with David Coffin producing it, wham. They would sell. I'd do it with somebody else who was every bit as interesting and as skilled and talented. No website, no big mailing list. We do the same amount of work. Nobody bought, nobody heard about it. So that's definitely just a reality of life. And Craftsy is very much a good example of that, whereas the Taunton Press Threads, they sort of already they already had their audience, and they were just trying to give them more stuff that they would continue to pay for. So, but in terms of putting the stuff together and my experience, it was great. The one last thing I will say about it is that the first time I was preparing the class, the trouser class, I kept thinking, well, this is great. There's all sorts of things that I want to say that aren't in the book I've already done and that wouldn't be in an article that I would do. But when I actually got there, it was really clear that in order to whip out those class lessons, you really had to abbreviate everything as opposed to elaborate on things. Now, I've seen a lot of the other Craftsy classes that a great benefit if you become a Craftsy author is that you get free access to all the other Craftsy classes. So I've got something like 300 Craftsy classes on my list. And of course, I don't have any time to look at them, but I've watched a few and some of them are very detailed and very much more info. Like for instance, I recently saw one on baking bread, which I keep thinking, maybe I'll do that. But it's really the bread I want. I don't want the baking problem. So I haven't actually done it, but I did watch a few classes and they were very, very detailed. No abbreviation, no sense of, well, they're hurrying over something that I should see. But I got that sense as a sewing teacher that I had to whip a lot of stuff by fairly quickly to get it shown. And I'm delighted to see that some people have been enjoying it. And you know, I do get a lot of good feedback about it. I've also answered lots and lots of questions. And I think that's a really strong part of the Craftsy platform. You know, there's more than a couple of Threads articles worth of answers and the continuing opportunity to ask questions and get more answers and post photos and get photos, you know, back. So I'm totally pro Craftsy.
That was a great question from Samina. Thank you. We have a question from Carol as well. Carol mm-hmm. is our resident fabric whisperer. That's her nickname. She wanted to know if you would touch on the big man altering and fitting in your new book. So will you do altering and fitting for larger men?
Well, that's definitely part of the idea. The problem with this whole fitting book has been finding a bunch of people to fit. I just don't know that many people who would be willing, I don't know anybody who'd be willing to come over to my house as often as I need them to come for all sorts of different fitting situations. So my solution so far has been to come up with a bunch of different dress forms that I can customize to reshape. And one of my definite goals is to pad out several of them to stand in for plus size people. And to talk about the fitting solutions that will work best for them. And as I said, I haven't done a lot of that. So, and I don't know anybody personally who's ever shared with me, well, what are the issues that they face as a sewer? But I do have a threads author that I worked with who's got a Craftsy class on plus size fitting. And I'm hopefully going to, I've watched her class and I've invited her to have a couple of pages in my book. She's obviously not going to write a whole chapter or provide a book on plus size fitting. She's already done that. Barbara Deckert is her name. And she's got a threads book on plus size fitting and a Craftsy class on it. But from the standpoint of shirt making, I'm definitely going to make a stab at that. If I'd be really grateful if there's somebody out there who makes clothes for a plus size guy or woman and would be willing to send me an example garment and then some photos of the bodies that those garments are supposed to fit. That's kind of my whole approach to working with shirts, and that is to see well, what shirt is already fitting you that you can buy? Let's take a look at that, see how well it actually does the job. But maybe we could start there. And the typical solution with ready-to-wear shirts for people who are basically, I could say people who are plus size in the shirt world are people who are a lot bigger below their shoulders than they are at the shoulders. So how do you go from having a certain kind of shoulder that isn't going to get bigger no matter how many pounds you put on or get or lose to having a much bigger circumference? This would go for people with really large busts or for bodybuilders. Their shoulders are getting bigger. So these are non-proportional, non-typical shapes. And the simple solution that ready-to-wear works on in shirts is just make the whole shirt wider. Forget the idea that you're going to fit the shoulders and then you're going to fit the rest of it. They just make everything bigger so that the shoulders for someone who's really got a big circumference below the shoulders, well, the yoke comes down to here. And the armholes are starting way out here. That's how they do it. And it makes sense. If you're going to manufacture shirts, they just come in extra small to XXXL and they just make them wider. So that's a good place to start. But the next question is, as a sewer, well, how can we customize that? How can we say, okay, well, let's get the shoulders to fit a little better without losing the circumference? And that's what I'm trying to figure out some solutions. And I would love to hear from somebody who's actually working with those issues and send me some photos and send me some pictures of the garments laying flat. You know, or if they're not willing to send me the garment, I'd be totally open to it and excited. So who's this we're looking at?
This is Carol. She just asked a question earlier and she's come on. Do you have a question for David, Carol? It's lovely to see you.
Actually, my question was about larger men. I sold my husband and he's built like a retired football player. His arms are huge, his neck is big, and then he has a belly as well. But then he has his bottom half is kind of, you know, his legs are not real big, and Mm-hmm. The challenge that I have usually when I make for him, I definitely have to draft. And the guy that I use are shirts that we buy from the store. I noticed that they're a little longer and the sleeves are longer. So when I do make him shirts, the sleeves have to be a little shorter because, right. You know, they make the shirts bigger. So the sleeves are longer, but the shirt is longer. So those are things that definitely I have to take in consideration when I do sew for him. I made a vest for him and I created a block. And the problem that I had first was when it was coming off of his belly, it was just shooting straight out. So I had to figure out how to bring it back in closer to the belly, down in the lower stomach area. So I worked and figured it out. And I actually have the muslin that I made for the vest. I keep it because I use it as a block for sweater vests and other things that I sew for him.
Makes sense.
But I'd like to know a little bit more about the bicep area because his arms are huge and they're actually muscular. So those are some issues that I have. But then the armhole, if it's too long, then it's adding too many saggy and too much wrinkling at the sides. So the hardest part would be fitting his stomach and then for a regular dress shirt, fitting his stomach and not making the shirt come all the way down to his thighs and knees. I've had success making shirts for him. Camp shirt styles seem to work really well for his body type. But the dress shirt I have not yet tackled completely because of the shape that I want. You know, I want it to be able to not hang in the, you know, hang so much in the front. I don't want it to be super long so that when he tucks it in, we got a whole bunch of fabric down the bottom. So I'm working on it. And I would love.
Well, how about we work together?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Let's talk.
Let's do that. Absolutely. Let's talk. I want to start an email and maybe even a Skype relationship with you so that you can show me what you're doing and I can learn from you and maybe come up with some help for you.
That would be.
But basically, I'm thinking in this case, you're the expert. You know what the problem is. And I'm just guessing at what the problem is. And I'm totally, one of the things that I've wanted to do, I've looked online to see if there are shirt companies that exclusively sell to not just plus size and, you know, extra large, but for weightlifters, bodybuilders.
They have really small waists, but large.
Right, exactly.
I actually have a friend who is a professional bodybuilder. Or he was a professional bodybuilder and he still lifts weights and he still has his body and he's extremely huge at the top and his waist is very small. And he's asked me to sew for him, but I'm not willing to take on the challenge because I know when the garment is hanging on the hanger, it's going to look totally crazy. But
Well, that's the first
puts it on
bit of wisdom.
Feed him. So I'm sure it'll fit him, but maybe I'll take on the challenge of bringing him in because he is definitely somebody else that would be totally hard to fit. You know, and he's a large guy. He's about 6'4". I have another friend that's a professional bodybuilder. He's about 5'11". So he's a little shorter, but he has a smaller frame. He's probably maybe about 175 pounds, where the other guy I'm talking about is like maybe he's about 250. So they're different.
Well, this is a thrill to me. this is what I've been looking for. Exactly. I need someone just like you with the friends you have. And I totally love to continue to work with you.
That would be great. Now we just have to convince my husband to be the fit model.
Yeah.
Right. Well,
did you want me to share your email in the comments, David?
Oh, yeah.
If you don't.
Absolutely.
Yes? Okay. Totally. I'll put it right here. Okay.
So you're Andrea, right?
No, I'm Carol. No,
Carol.
Another. Okay, Carol. Well, it's a pleasure to meet you, and I hope we can continue to work together on this.
Oh, we definitely will, because I would love to figure out the answer to the questions and if I could sew for him all the time, that would be wonderful, because shopping for him is a little bit, it's kind of disappointing for him, but, and then when we do find the stuff, he's a fashionable guy. It's never, you know, nice enough for him. You know, he doesn't like the style, or I don't like this, or right. I don't like that. So that's to be great. Great.
Yeah, I agree totally.
Well,
I guess this was the reason I came to this experience, to meet you.
Wonderful, wonderful. Okay, sounds good. You'll be here for
so I'll see you soon.
My emails now.
Yes.
I will. Don't worry.
All right.
Believe me, you're heaven sent. So I'm not going to ignore it.
Okay. Thank you, Carol.
Thanks, yeah. Dawn. Bye.
All right. See you soon.
Okay. It looks like in the comments, Andrea, and she's very good. Her main thing is fit, or she's sewed to fit. She also says that her husband has an athletic build with large biceps and, you know, like an odd shape too. So she would probably be a fantastic person.
Well, I see her link there. I'll definitely go there, and I'm totally equally interested in talking to her afterwards and working with her too. I mean, I've only questions in this area. I don't have any real experience. I certainly have a lot of opinions again. I mean, but my main opinion is on this area comes from occasionally dropping in on that HBO show called Ballers, I think it is, where they've got Dwayne Johnson is one of the stars. The idea is that he's an agent for football, professional football players. And the only reason I watch is to see, well, what kind of shirt is this enormously gigantic athletic Dwayne guy wearing? What's his solution? In fact, I've got to say, that's really what my life has been all about in terms of clothes these days. Watching television with my camera, taking pictures of what, my God, look at that amazing garment there, or look how interestingly that fits or doesn't fit. I'm so grateful for this new world we live in where there are big screen, high definition televisions, and you can really see what people are wearing. It's very clear, and I'm all over that.
You could probably write to the show and ask the people, and they'd probably, you know,
I thought of that. I just
author. They'd probably, you know, help you out.
Maybe.
Yeah, that'd be great. Yes.
But I'm glad to see all these people making clothes or struggling to make clothes for muscular males in their lives. I'd love to learn from them.
Yes. Well, I've kept you far over the time, and we've forgotten.
I'm just getting started.
Oh, yeah. And we even forgot to mention, you mentioned your Pinterest page the other day. So I can't believe I didn't see it before. So I actually went and had a look at it, and there is tons of fantastic boards in here. It's like, I love Pinterest. So, I mean, this is eye candy here. There's really, so I put the link in the notes. But it's shirt making with DPC. So you guys do not want to miss that.
Well, Pinterest is a fantastic thing. I've loved it right from the beginning. I first was interested in it when what I was doing was painting. There's no better way to collect and browse for fantastic art images than Pinterest. Then when I switched back to doing some sewing work, it was also clear that, my God, that Pinterest is just a treasure chest. And of course, it's a great storage area. The most frustrating thing for me these days is that so many of the points that I'm wondering how to make in my new book, I could so easily make if I just take a Pinterest image and drop it into the book, but of course, can't do that. So I've been thinking about how to write the book and be able to say, be sure to check out my Pinterest boards for called whatever, for examples of fitting problems or fitting solutions that I think are interesting. or custom-made dress form ideas. That's another thing that's going to be in this book, is the idea of some easy ways that I've come up with, relatively easy, for making customized dress forms, because I think that is so essential for people who make clothes for themselves. Absolutely critical. How are you going to fit on yourself without needing to depend on other people? Mm. So that's a big interest of mine, and that's going to be in this book.
It's going to be a great book.
Well, hopefully.
How far along are you on writing the book? Just curious.
I'm behind, I have to say.
Okay.
As you can see, one of the things I wanted to do was to find somebody who could help me understand the plus size and the super athletic muscular figure. And this was it. I haven't found it until now. Yay. So, yeah, really good.
That's fabulous.
Very helpful.
Wow. Yes. Yeah,
so any other questions? Last minute?
Oh, stuff? I'll double check to see. Oh, and we haven't gone over the poll too.
Yeah, let's quickly go over the poll.
Okay. So our poll was, if you haven't had a chance to answer it, if you just scroll down, we have three questions for you. The first one was, what's the most challenging aspect of sewing for you? And the winner by far with 8 votes is fitting. So it's fitting.
Just what I was expecting.
Yes. So fitting, choosing patterns, finding the right fabric, designing something unique / personal, and mastering the many different tools and techniques, which was the second. Yes. And what's the hardest part of fitting for you? And our possible answers were being willing to make a muslin, knowing what good fit looks like, distinguishing between what fits well and what's most flattering, knowing how to respond to obvious fitting issues in your existing garments or projects in process, and choosing between and understanding various fitting solutions and methods. And this one is a bit closer, between being willing to make a muslin, 44%, and choosing between understanding various fitting solutions / methods, which is 33%. So again,
yeah, these are very gratifying answers for me, because they're precisely what I'm hoping to deal with in this book.
Yeah. And the last one, which of these have you tried? Pin fitting, tissue fitting, slash and spread, flat pattern manipulation, and full bust alteration? And yeah, pretty much kind of a tie between pin fitting. Whoops, it's changing as I speak. Pin fitting, slash and spread, and flat pattern manipulation were level, but now pin fitting is out above the rest of them. So I'm very happy that that's helpful to you. It kind of just reinforced what you already believed, though, didn't it?
Right. Well, that's very helpful. I mean, if it had been completely the opposite to what I've been assuming all these years, that would have been trouble. But yeah, these are exactly my experiences as a sewer. And so that these are the things that I'm focusing on in this book. And short answer or short hint, basically the pin fitting, what I mean by that is, okay, you've actually got a muslin or the garment you're making, and you're putting it on your body or the person you're making it for, and you're adjusting it with pins. And to me, that's no matter what other method you use, that you're eventually going to get to that point. You have to pin fit. So my whole idea is that you should basically start there and skip over the flat pattern adjusting and just go right to the draping fabric on yourself, or starting with a muslin and fixing it. So that's another clue is, if you've been resisting making muslins and you're still struggling with fit, I put those two things together and say, well, that's the reason you gotta make a muslin. So, and that same idea goes for all the technique, everything I've ever learned about sewing. To me, the answer is being willing to make samples. Yep. Because if you think about it, any serious project of making clothes for people, on the manufacturing level or the dressmaking level or whatever, it's based on deep experience. A designer doesn't just whip out an idea and then send it to the factory. they send it to their sample maker. Let's see the prototype. And let's then, well, they've got a person they've hired to do nothing but make samples. And the idea that they're going to need to make only one sample to get a yes is has got to be rare. Much more likely to make dozens of samples, unless it's the same thing they've been making forever and they're just changing one little aspect of it. But that's why the career of sample maker exists in the garment industry, because they need to see samples. They need to see examples. Let's work it out. Looking at flat patterns is not going to do it. We got to see it, see the real thing. And anybody who's good at any sewing technique is good because they've done it a lot. So I never make a project without getting to a detail that I haven't made before and then saying, all right, I'm going to make a sample first. I'm not going to just cut my precious fabric and assume that I'll work through the directions. To me, that was the weirdest and worst part of my early sewing training, was to be in a sewing class where the teacher would say, well, you cut out all the pieces first and then bring it over to me if you're running into any trouble. And so in my early, this is how the classes that I could find were like in the late 70s, early 70s. If I got through a garment doing that, I had learned absolutely nothing. I might have come out with a garment at the end, but I didn't know how to do it. Someone else had taken care of the tricky part. And so the very first thing that I wanted to do with my, when I thought I'd write a book about this, was I'm going to stop and figure out everything that's tricky to the point where I totally understand it and can describe it and even make the pattern for it. And if I can't do that, I don't understand it. I don't know it. And that just meant making lots of samples.
Yep. Even in school, we had to have a sample folder, and you didn't just do one of them. You had to do like five, and some of them were at each stage, and you'd stop. And I still have them in my room. And once in a while, I'm like, I can't remember how to do something. You go back and look at it. So, and muslins too, like they're just integral to making something, especially if you're doing it from scratch, not using an existing pattern. Yeah, so important. So yeah, I can see with your eye for detail that even your next book is going to be absolutely fabulous.
I hope so.
Oh yeah.
I'm feeling a lot more optimistic about it after this session here. Definitely.
Oh, the lady did fabulous.
You will be hearing from me, believe me.
That's very good. Yes. So on a parting note, when we were discussing things in our test, you were talking about, it was quite inspiring really, about how the type of community sewing is and how it is a place that is supportive for you to not, you know, find your niche, make a career. It's in compared to being like an artist, where if you wanted to be an artist, there's not a lot of ways to be known and to really stand out. Where in the sewing community, it's a completely different beast. So I was wondering if you...
To me, the difference, and this kind of came to me as we were hashing it over, the big difference between the sewing world and any other world I've been involved in with some ambition is that the sewing world is not that competitive. In other words, if you're an artist, you're just one of hundreds or thousands of artists, and we're all clamoring for the limelight, and we all know that we're not going to make it unless all of a sudden the limelight hits us for a minute. You know, I mean, it's true with music and all kinds of other arts. Lots of people do it, but very few are chosen. But in the sewing world, the sewing process world, in other words, the world of makers as opposed to the world of designers, who are just like artists. They have to wait for the spotlight to hit them too. But if the topic is sewing how-to information of any sort, on any level, on any aspect of it, it seems to me there's always room for new people, for anybody who's got a slightly new take. And whether it's a take of, you know, my response to that take was, well, let's take this more seriously than usual. Let's spend more time. Let's write 50 pages on hand sewing instead of 2 pages. Yeah. That's just one aspect of it. The other aspect is, let's take this 50 pages and bring it down to one page that really works. That's equally good, equally interesting. Not maybe to the same people, but there's enough people out there who want something specific that there's room for it. So anyway, my point is to be encouraging, based on my own experience, that if your own passion for sewing has led you to really feel like you know some aspect of it, and you're thinking, well, how could I maybe monetize this somehow? I don't know all the different ways of monetizing it. The world is changing all the time, and there's clearly some competition for the top spot as the most popular blogger, et cetera, et cetera. But it's definitely been my experience, and I think it's still true, that if you decide you're going to put out into the world what you're starting to know about, the world is going to be interested, and they're not going to say, well, I don't have room for time for you. I'm going to go with the fancy person, the person who's already the star of this world. And the stardom thing and the competition for the spotlight just really doesn't apply as much to the sewing world. It's a world like pretty much any other special interest makers group, I guess, on the internet. It's people are starving for information and for the possibility to exchange with other people. So I think it's a great place to look for that combination between doing what you love and also being supported to some extent by what you love doing.
I agree. Well, on that note, just a little side note, if you don't mind, David, I got some cards this week from people saying thank you kind of thing. So Faye, also the people who watched That Sewing Blab sent me a card. All the people from the Pericrafters and So Much Talent people.
How wonderful.
Yeah, it was very nice of them, just saying that they liked the show, and I wanted to say thank you. So the perfect example of what you're talking about, David, that it is a very lovely, supportive community. And I mean, what could be better? We all love sewing and discussing sewing. So it's fantastic that the internet allows us to get together like this.
I totally agree.
Yes. Now, I'm definitely hoping that you will come back on the show.
Love to.
Oh, great. And I'm so sorry about
work.
Yeah, I know. So sorry about the technical difficulties. It's not normally like this. I don't know what happened. But I appreciate you hanging in there and the audience hanging in there. It was fantastic that you guys came along and stayed. And yes, I can't wait to have you on again, David. You were absolutely fabulous. And if you don't already have these books, guys, I'm serious. They're amazing. If you're not, yeah, they're just amazing. So
thank you, Dawn.
Oh, no problem at all. It's been lovely chatting with you all. And yes, I hope you have a lovely.
Well, let's everybody give Dawn a big hand here. This is her first solo venture, as far as I understand. Her co-host somehow, for some reason, didn't show up and may not be available in the future. So my opinion is that's too bad that we didn't have her here, but Dawn, you can do it all yourself.
Thank you. That's pretty fabulous of you. Thank you. It was a little crazy with the technical stuff, but it's such a great group of ladies here that we pulled it off. Yay, we survived.
And we had Michael here.
Michael. We don't normally. And Michael was very helpful in the comments. Thank you very much,
Michael. He's got a great blog. I really advise people to go check out his blog. He's just started to study draping on the college level, which is pretty fascinating.
What's his blog called?
If he's still here,
Michael, could you tell us the name of your blog? I'm sure our viewers would be very interested. They do Line of Selvage. Oh, I'll definitely look it up too. Thank you very much. Michael was great. Oh, well, it sounds like he's fantastic too. So, yes. Now, part of the reason why I'm rushing us off, even though it has been long, is because we started at one time, there's normally a 2-hour window, but because we had technical difficulties, we stopped. But I'm a little worried it'll just chop off out of nowhere if we go over that 2-hour window.
Well, let's do it again. I would be thrilled to do another one of these whenever you want to.
Oh, no, it would be amazing. And definitely when we talk about shirts and when your new book comes out. And yes, it was very nice of you to come on. So,
all right.
Any
so long, everybody. David?
So long, okay.
All right.
Thanks, everyone. Have a great night. Bye.